I'd like to thank everyone for joining us today. Welcome you all to the Consumer Electronics Show here in Las Vegas, Nevada. I'm Mike Bergman. I'm Vice President of Standards and Technology at CTA. And it's really gratifying to see so many people in the audience. And also, we've got a live stream going out. I want to welcome everybody on the interwebs for joining us. Today, we've got a great discussion queued up for you on secure development lifecycle. It's an important topic. It's important for mature organizations to be preparing their product in a way that produces good product rather than trying to look at the process and build the security in late in the game. With us today, we have immediately to my left, Christian Troncoso. You know, I stumble over your name every time I have to say it. Christian is Director of Policy for BSA, the Software Alliance. Gunder Lambring is Senior Business Development Manager and Identity Management and Security for UL. Alan Friedman is the Director of Cybersecurity Initiatives at NTIA, the National Telecommunications and Information Administration, in the U.S. Department of Commerce. And VG Garg is the Senior Director of Research, Innovation, and External Affairs for Comcast. So, if you're keeping score, we have people from a variety of segments. We have a government agent, right? we have a device and media company representative. We have a standards body. We have an assessment body. So these are all representative of the different elements or vectors where cybersecurity comes in.
You left one out. You have one lawyer. I know this crowd probably loves to be lectured about cybersecurity by their legal department, so I'll try to keep my comments fairly high level.
You know, I love this because I'm in a lot of cybersecurity meetings, and invariably, I'm the only engineer. There's all these lawyers talking about cybersecurity policy, and I'm sitting there saying, well, yeah, but what about the engineering side? Okay, so let's start off with what we're talking about in the first place, because we do want to do a little bit of SDL 101, Secure Development Lifecycle 101. Secure Development Lifecycle has a long history, a relatively long history as the consumer electronics world goes. Microsoft was a big early proponent. You'll hear Secure Development Lifecycle, Software Development Lifecycle, Secure Software Development Lifecycle, Secure Design Lifecycle. So there's been a lot of variety, and there's been some success in deploying these. There's even a process out there to measure development best practices by BSIMM. B-S-I-M-M. It's BSIMM.com. You can look that up. A lot of best practices in there. But we have a representative here whose organization actually did a framework to structure this up in a uniform way, and I want to turn this over now to Christian to explain a little bit more as a kind of a backdrop for what we're talking about when we talk about secure development lifecycle. Christian?
Sure. Thanks, Mike. So I think, as Mike alluded to, the concept of a secure development lifecycle has been around, I think, since probably the late 90s, early 2000s. It's more or less just a recognition that security needs to be baked into a software product or service at every phase of its life cycle, from the sort of moment of conception, while it's being coded, after it's been deployed, and even sort of some of the end-of-life considerations that need to be thought of depending on the nature of the product or service. So conceptually, there's a lot of agreement throughout the industry that this is the right approach to how you create a secure product. But unfortunately, it has sort of developed organically within organizations. And so my organization represents a lot of enterprise software companies, sort of the Microsofts and Oracles and IBMs of the world. And even though they do a lot of things the same way, their development teams may use different terminology, may use different sort of coding frameworks, and as a result, even when these mature companies are talking to one another, they sometimes talk past one another, and it creates, you spend a lot of cycles trying to map out one organization's SDL to another. So there was a consensus among our organizations that it might be helpful to try and create more or less sort of an industry standard approach to how we talk and conceptualize the SDL. So that's what gave rise to our sort of iteration of a secure development lifecycle framework. And as I mentioned earlier, the SDL works throughout the lifecycle of software. And so ours is sort of formulated around three stages: the development stage, the lifecycle stage, which would be end of life, patchability, those sorts of things. And then what I think makes ours a little bit unique is that we identify specific secure capabilities that software and software services should integrate. So that's things like patchability and encryption strategy, logging, and sort of authorization and access controls, which we think at this point are industry standards and should be resident in any sort of software or software service. I think we'll get into some of these capabilities more as the panel goes on. So sort of what... turn it back over.
Yeah, that's great. That's a good touch point, starting point. And what I'd like to do, can we go to the next slide, please? So with BSA's framework, and that's available from the website?
Yeah, sorry, I should have mentioned that. Yeah, bsa.org, it should be on our homepage. If you just Google BSA security framework, I think it's the top result.
Yeah, and I can recommend it if this is a new topic for you. It's pretty readable to just try to understand what kinds of secure practices you should have, you should be thinking about. And if you see something on that list that you're not doing, it's maybe a little bit of a red flag.
And
so it's a great starting point.
Yeah, and just each of the sort of practices and best practices points to informative references. So a lot of the ISO standards that are out there, NIST documents that are out there, and other sort of the Microsoft Secure Development Lifecycle documentation as well. So we are not creating anything whole cloth here. The goal really was just to create a framework of best practices that are out there and put it into something that is easily digestible for small organizations all the way up to the sort of largest enterprise companies in the world.
Great, great. Now, that's a starting point, we said, and it's useful in and of itself. So that's your first takeaway, bsa.org.
Yep.
VG, go ahead.
So very quickly, so the framework is definitely a great starting point, but I do think, like, depending upon the size of your organization, depending upon the maturity of your organization, and depending upon the kind of development work you're doing, I think you might need to, you know, select a few of those practices. Like, you have to follow sort of like the 80-20 rule, right? Like, there's going to be, you know, five things that you can do that is going to yield a big dividend in terms of how it improves your security. And then there's going to be a long tail of things that you can continue to do. And I'm not, I think the 80 is going to differ based on the kind of organization you have and what kind of products you're building and things like that. So I think, like, one thing as people are starting to implement some of these programs, it is kind of important to have some kind of security outcome that you're driving towards, right? So it could be, well, I want to receive fewer, reports from third-party researchers saying that, hey, I found a vulnerability in your product, right? And then measure what you're doing as part of your SDL and look at which of those practices correlate best in terms of getting that outcome. So so there is a little bit of an art, but there's also a little bit of science.
Absolutely, and I think the goal with the framework was really to create something that was flexible enough to enable organizations of all maturity levels to make use of it,
right,
but also specific enough that it could, there are some measurable aspects,
right,
of it. But then even within that, I think to your point, if you're an organization, depending on your maturity level, you're going to want to create your own metrics for measuring these outcomes and seeing, sort of creating goals and sort of baselines for how you assess whether you are meeting your own organization's sort of goal.
Right.
Yeah, an assessment-based approach. Yeah, looking at what your priorities and risks are and that assessing those and then prioritizing your resources and activities based on that. Now, BSA is a framework, right?
Yep.
And then it's in a specific category. What other frameworks or sort resources are available out there for people. Can anybody talk to what other resources that, that buttress the SDL would be available?
Yeah, maybe I can compliment to what Christian was already explaining. There's a lot of SDL guidance out there. The BSA framework is a great example. And arguably, enterprises are managing their network infrastructure and their enterprises, applications. They have a level of experience. And one of the key questions that UL is also addressing is how does it translate to the world of IoT, to product manufacturers, and what they should be doing to securely design their products. And various industry organizations and policy bodies have started to think about this as we bring more devices online and it involves the physical world around us, then what is fit for purpose there? And we put up this slide where we highlight some of the key discussions and some of the frameworks that we have seen emerge, both in the US and Europe, and then actually there's other examples globally. Maybe to highlight a few, NIST has done some really great work. They've done great work in the past with the NIST cybersecurity framework, but then specifically for IoT products, they've defined what should be secure capabilities in an average product, baseline security capabilities. So really the minimum security that you can expect enabled in a product is the NIST A259 document. It's a draft today, but it's a good source to familiarize yourself with what should be applicable at a product level. Industry has done a similar exercise where hosted by the Council to Secure the Digital Economy, CSDE, and also with help from CTA, the Consumer Technology Association, they have come together and said with 20 other industry organizations, including UL, but also AHEM and other industry representatives, what if we discuss this, what do we think are baseline capabilities for products? And similarly to the NIST framework came up with what we called the C2 consensus. It's another great guidance document. And from there, we can get to more specific requirements, language, standards. CTA is also working on a baseline standard. So to then drill it down further into actual measurable requirements. On the other side of the pond in Europe, there's been some great guidance put forward by the UK government. They've put together a code of practice for consumer IoT, which is another great resource. And ETSI and Sensenelec have started standardization effort in Europe as well. So there's a draft European standard for baseline security. That's a whole lot of information, but those are all great resources, and it's complementary as to what BSA and other organizations have worked on, maybe more from an enterprise point of view, drilling down as to what does it mean for IoT. As you all, we are very active in this space, and what we ultimately want to achieve is that product security is well understood, it's measurable, and it's transparent to the end users and to consumers what security is built into products. And we are actively contributing to all of this guidance and standardization effort and also designing conformity assessment options and product labeling options. So one great example is the IoT security rating solution that we have developed where consumer IoT manufacturers can come to us, can get the products assessed and get a label as to what security is built into the product at various levels from bronze to diamond. GE Appliances is an example of a manufacturer that we've helped with the security assessment and are leveraging this as an option for their products.
That's great. That's I was taking a couple of quick notes as that fire hose of information went by because it was really great. You mentioned the NIST 8259. That's a NIST interagency report that's in draft now. So you can find that by Googling NIST IR 8259. The C2 consensus you can get by Googling C2 consensus, C the letter C, number 2, and then the word consensus. UL is, you'd find it by looking for on the UL homepage, actually.
Yeah, UL.com, and then please search for IoT security rating.
And we'll let the Europeans promote their own work, but maybe we'll just mention that the UK Code of Practice is available from DCMS and the... ETSI Sensenelec work, I think you just have to go on a hunt because I can't tell you how to find that right now. I don't have it at the top of my head. But anyway, there's a lot of information out there available. So there's a lot of pieces you can get to. And these are, these documents, as I've seen, all of these documents, do respect the distinction between the design phase and later phases, or the design part of the secure development lifecycle, the secure design lifecycle, and the later phases. So let's look at the design point at the moment. We've got these codes of practices and consensus documents, but what can we learn from organizations that are already mature and already doing product that is following an SDL, following a secure program? What can we learn? Anybody?
Sure. Yeah, I can jump in and sort of, I think one of the, with the SDL, it's difficult to sort of separate the phases because they all kind of bleed into one another. But to your point, on the design phase, one of the key sort of steps for any SDL is to do sort of a threat analysis and risk modeling, and threat modeling rather, to look at the sort of the types of risks that your product may pose. But I think really threat modeling is done best when you also take into account the sophistication of your the people that will be using your product. And so your question was about who is doing this well. I'm going to go a slightly different direction, which is we got a great example of organizations that were not doing it well a few years ago with the Mirai botnet, right? So that was an example where, you know, there's 8 billion or so IoT devices out there. This botnet was able to co-opt about 500,000 of them and turn them into a sort of a big DDoS attack that was leveraged in against various targets. But that was an example where you had a lot of IoT devices that used hard-coded passwords that were easily guessable, and these devices also were not patchable over the air. And to the, my point earlier was about threat modeling and thinking through who your consumers are. In this instance, a lot of these things were security cameras, which are, you know, consumers put them somewhere hard to reach. And so the idea that they're going to pull those things off of the wall and plug them into a computer in order to update them is just unrealistic threat modeling. And so that is an example where a device really needs to have over-the-air patchability capabilities in order to mitigate risks as they arise. And so I think we will see more of that as IoT device makers become more mature in their approaches to SDL.
That's great. That's a great example. And I just want to point out that in today's world, you cannot have a cybersecurity panel without somebody bringing up the Mirai botnet. In fact, I'm going to codify that now and call it, that's Bergman's Law.
Okay.
If you cannot have a panelist or presentation on cybersecurity in the IoT without talking about the Mirai botnet. But it's a great example, and it did take down the U.S. Internet in October 2016. It took down the U.S. Internet for a day. And it was what led to Executive Order 13800, which was signed by President Trump in May of 2017, and that led to the botnet report and botnet roadmap done by our friends at the Department of Commerce and Department of Homeland Security. And that the roadmap in particular has driven quite a bit of activity in industry and in government and in public-private partnerships. In parallel, though, I know one of the techniques that's been looked at for, I want to say it's an evolving element, is software bill of materials in terms of knowing actually what components of software are in the delivered product. If you know that there's a problem with a particular algorithm, a particular protocol, if an exploit has been discovered, do you necessarily know what's in the software? Alan, you did the industry and government leading work on a multi-stakeholder process. Can you talk about that?
Sure. So the nice thing about being in this room is it sort of invokes the idea of a bill of materials, right? If you make a device, obviously you need to know what's in it. And it's pretty interesting that we don't have that expectation for software. So I guess we can do a quick audience poll. If we read about this afternoon, we have discovered a new vulnerability in arbitrary, widely used open source library X. There's a big flaw in a real-time operating system or a busy box Linux. raise your hand if your organization can quickly and easily identify whether or not any of your products are affected. You got a few hands, and that's wonderful. I would argue that you guys are in the very wealthy minority on the maturity scale. That is fantastic. And our vision here is to say we need that the minimum amount of transparency we should have on connected devices is what we get when we buy a Twinkie from a store. Right? You go and buy a piece of candy, it comes with a list of ingredients. Why don't we have this for our software? Because when we know it's there, then we can begin to take these basic protections. Right? And if you can't patch, we can dive into patching, you can take other types of defensive approaches. And we can talk a lot more about patching, also happy to dive in more into the details of SBOM, but one of the things that we've tried to do at the Department of Commerce is to say, we're not going to come up with a solution ourselves. We're not going to try to write the standard. What we do believe is there should be a standard that meets the needs of industry. And when I say industry, I mean big tent, everyone. Where we want the open source community at the table, we want vendors at the table, and we want customers at the table. So that, you know, while we care a lot about the security of devices, and you care about the security of your devices, you know who probably cares a lot about making sure that the microphone isn't easily hackable on a smart TV? The hotel company that you stayed in last night. And so trying to drive that type of commercial leverage up the supply chain.
Okay, that's great. And I know that this is an evolving topic. The standards are available and it's also evolving. And there's more to be found by going to the Department of Commerce NIST.gov website. I'm sorry, NTIA.gov website. Whoops.
NTIA.gov/SBOM. We are very proud that is one of the shortest URLs in the entire history of cybersecurity policy. NTIA.gov/SBOM. S-B-O-M.
I like it. Okay. Thank you. So once you build the product, these design capabilities, these minimum capabilities that we heard about in the NIST 8259 and in the C2 consensus and in the UK code of practice. So those, how do we know that they're there? What do we do about assessment? Gondo, you're from an assessment body.
Yeah. So it's great that product manufacturers start to adhere to security by design capabilities and design it into their products, and ultimately, once a product gets to the marketplace as well, how is that demonstrable? So one of the most obvious ways to demonstrate that you've actually implemented secure design capabilities and maintenance capabilities in your product, and you actually know what software is in your product, and you indeed have a list of software components that you actively manage, is through going to an assessment. And there's, you know, various flavors of assessment options. It can be third-party, self-assessment. We, of course, are an example of a third-party conformity assessment body. But ultimately, that's one of the ways to demonstrate and prove to the marketplace that the product meets those capabilities. And then we get to the marketplace, and a great example, Alan, for mentioning in a hotel chain, that's where the marketplace should start exercising its power in purchasing decisions. Am I going to look for proof that this product has met or is meeting capabilities, and that this can be demonstrated either through assessment, certification, labeling, other ways to demonstrate that the product meets these requirements. So that's where the purchasing and the design and source stage, the sourcing part should come in as well.
One of the things, Mike, that I really like about the BSA framework as well as the C2 consensus document is this emphasis on measurable outcomes. And I think as we look at trying to reform IoT security and create a positive feedback loop in the market, a great place to start is on the things that are cheaper to measure. It's one of the reasons that, you know, NTI like the idea of focusing on patchability, either have it or you don't, and we tried to lay out by the way, when we say something's patchable, here's roughly what we mean. So for example, if your patching mechanism is not cryptographically signed, That's not a patching mechanism, that's a remote code exploit, and those are bad. But I think there are other frameworks out there that have focused on this. So you talked about the UK Code of Practice. The three things they picked are all fairly easy to validate. There's an incredible role for much more in-depth assessment, and I really love the fact that UL is leading this and working with large companies. But there's also some value in just some of the very simple questions. So for example, a vulnerability disclosure policy. How many of your organizations make it easy for a security researcher to say, we have found a flaw in your product, can we tell you about it? I was hoping for a few more hands on that one. Because as one senior policymaker said, if you can't accept free security consulting, we've got a lot more work to do. Working with hackers is complex and difficult. It's something I've tried to do while working for the US government, and that means there's a lot of trust challenges. But I think it's something that we absolutely need to do as a community, is build that mindset that things aren't going to be perfect, emphasize being able to quickly adapt to security flaws that we can identify, and then of course fix them.
So I do like the, I think like it's important to not just think in terms of, like when we're talking about measurement, thinking in terms of metrics, because that is kind of a challenge in its own, right? We kind of know like, how do you measure security? Well, how do you measure happiness? So I do like the idea of having things that you can relatively easily validate at a low cost, right? So one of the things that, going back to the Mirai botnet attack, right? Like right after Mirai botnet, there was a slew of best practices, like within just like the next 2 months or so, best practices, IoT standards, and a bunch of different advice that came out. And there's a professor at Indiana University, Jean Kam, she's a AAAS fellow, and I think an IEEE fellow. She wrote a paper titled, Does Good Advice Matter? At least I hope that's the name of the paper, but you can search for it. One of the things she found out was that even if a manufacturer implemented all of the slew of advice that had come out within the next couple of months, the Mirai botnet would still have happened. Because one of the things that was not a part of that advice was don't have default passwords. Right, so you do need to have some basic cyber hygiene practices, right? And this is where like I feel like something like the C2 consensus document, which has gone through a fairly rigorous deliberation, I guess. You know, it was not something that came out the week after Mirai happened. Does kind of set those basic cyber hygiene practices that you'd want to do as an organization. And one of the cyber hygiene practices is you should have a mechanism where third-party researchers can report any vulnerabilities that they have found, right? And there was a big discussion of, well, what if you have a small organization and they are not able to, you know, have an infrastructure for reporting? And I was like, well, you can easily have security@organization.org. That is not a big ask. And if it is a big ask to have an email address where third-party researchers can send you security vulnerabilities, I think you should ask the question, what am I doing making IoT devices?
Yeah, that's a pretty fair point. The way you characterized it at the end is that security should not be seen as an option or a version 2 element. It's if you're not looking at security in the first place, maybe we shouldn't have you in the ecosystem, right? What are the best practices? If you go through all of these documents, we've already talked about SBOM, vulnerability disclosure, and being able to be visible to security researchers. We've talked about
Software updates.
Patchability. Thank you. So if you look at something like the NIST document, the 8259, I know it's got six basic capabilities, at least in the prior draft, and I believe the new draft does also. And the C2 consensus has a bunch of basic capabilities. What are some good examples from those that fit into the SDL, and where do they fit in an SDL?
I will highlight maybe two examples. I think we all worked on these types of discussions and documents together as well, so anyone can add to this. But device identity and having a secure device identity on the network is another key capability. So we already highlighted no default passwords, and it has been one of the causes of some of the indeed large-scale botnet attacks, including Mirai, if that is not in place. So having secure password, having or secure keys, secure cryptographic credentials, and having a policy to manage those also throughout the lifecycle of the product is important. So it's design and then also lifecycle maintenance. And same goes for, we talked about vulnerability disclosure. That means that if I get new information about new risks and new vulnerabilities through whatever means, I have to have a policy how to manage these for my product. So that's one of the key things that UL and its IoT security rating is also assessing, that a manufacturer has that ability that you can actually do vulnerability management for your products for the lifetime or for however long you maintain those products.
I think something that's useful to note about these properties, which is both a benefit and a challenge, is there is not a single way to do any one of these. And of course, that is wonderful given the rich diversity of our ecosystem. So device identity can be, you know, baked in from your Snapdragon chip, or you can use Dane and the DNS system, because we've thought about how to do that. However, if you're just trying to say, tell me what to do so I can do it, that's where we don't yet have the out-of-the-box approach. There are more and more actors in the ecosystem who you can sort of wander out to the shop floor and say, oh, we can now do this through the various platforms that have been from some of the vendors. I don't want to promote any particular approach, but most of the major tech vendors have built out these IoT security platforms that can handle a lot of that heavy lifting. So I think there is still room for smaller new organizations who can't hire a perfect security expert to still build out something and then have it at a high enough level that it can meet the C2 consensus, or they can even take it to UL and get certified.
And I do want to kind of touch on that point, right? Like there are many different ways to do these things. There's no one correct way, but they are known incorrect ways, right? So, and you know, there's enough news and there's enough articles out there for you to be able to figure out what is not the right way to do things, right? Like Alan mentioned one of them, right? Like if your device updates are not being validated that they're coming from the correct source in some way, shape, or form, that is a remote port exploit vector, right? So, and you should be aware of that. This is not news to anyone anymore. And to that point, really, all of that security at some point is contingent on having a robust, reliable device identity, right? And I just wanted to kind of touch on Ghana's point of, because everything builds on top of that. If you can't establish taking the academic terminology, like if you have two parties, Alice and Bob, and you can't validate that Alice is Alice and Bob is Bob, you can't provide any security guarantee without having that. So I there's a lot of far-reaching stuff that we can do, but there's a lot that we can achieve by doing very, very basic things right. Things that are not necessarily particular to IoT, right? Like those are things that we've known about software development for a long time, even when we are doing software for laptops and everything else.
Yeah.
IoT does make it a little bit more tricky, but...
Yeah, just to add one sentence to that, this is not rocket science, and there's actually examples of verticals or pockets of industry where some of these capabilities have been baked into software and products for a long time, and it doesn't take a whole lot to figure out what are some of the minimal things. If the UK is asking for 3 things to do, C2 consensus is asking for maybe 20 things to do, it's not a high barrier to reach for an average manufacturer.
Yeah. I mean, it's not even, you know, rocket science, right? It's not even aviation science, right? Like there's no N version programming that you're doing here.
Yeah.
So you're writing one version of the code, you can get it right.
So we basically have solved rocket science at this point. I want to nominate quantum computing. It's not quantum computing.
All right, fair
that's
enough.
That's my new metric for something that's really hard to understand. Cybersecurity is not quantum computing.
Well, because cybersecurity is possible today.
Yeah. okay, so now we've talked about if you're, let's say, the manufacturer, the developer, or the organization that is producing the device. What if you are sourcing devices? What about where does this come into play? If you're actually thinking about protecting your brand, protecting your own customers downstream of you, protecting your operations, if you're sourcing devices, what can you do in the context of SDL?
I mean, I think at the most basic level, if you are sourcing devices, you have the opportunity to ensure that all of your supply chain partners are meeting the same level of security that you would expect your own product to achieve, because ultimately the reputation of your own company is going to ride on the security of your supply chain partners in some way. And I think that there's increasing recognition of that. And I mean, I think if you look across industry right now, people are hungry for frameworks that are sort of common and consensus-based that make it easier and cheaper and without the need for as many lawyers to get those sort of certifications. And that's why I think organizations like UL play a really important role.
And this gets back to a lot of the cost of measurement. The third-party certification marketplace has exploded in the software world to the point there is now an entire trade organization devoted to third-party assessment of security. Very important, but also expensive. So if we're trying to have something that can scale for high volume, lower margin products, we need something that's a little more efficient. And so again, looking for the things that are easy to measure, or even more important, so I will take the fact that I will take exception, I have a background in engineering, I just wasn't a very good one. So I also decided to become a mediocre economist. We talk about efficient signals in economics, where if you have a good process, this is a cheap signal. If you have a bad process, this is expensive. And this is where I'm going to go back to the software bill of materials comes in. Can you produce a software bill of materials? Can you tell me all of your software components that you're shipping? If you have a secure development lifecycle process, if the way you build software has a clearly defined process, then it really shouldn't be that hard to say, hey, where are you compiling it? Please extract the data. If you have a very long, complex, legacy, waterfall, loopy development process, it's going to be hard to extract that data. It's also going to be hard to say that you've thought through the security of your development. And so looking for those things like patchability, I'm very happy. I think the work that we did on patching sort of got the word patchability into the jargon of this world. But and SBOM and a lot of the other work that we see in the C2. So what can we easily measure?
And just on that point, right? Like there's definitely space for third-party assessment, but then a lot of security is very, very hard to measure, right? So, but how do I really know that you have? So the company that is building all of my software, what is their dedication to security? Like how well trained are their coders? How well trained is the security team? And when we focus kind of more on the metric side of things, you tend to lose a lot of the other things that are harder to measure, right? It's very well established, like you tend to measure things that are easier to measure. So, you do need to look for those proxy signals, right? And I want to go back to the notion of, if this company does not accept vulnerabilities from third-party researchers, that is a bad signal. Not that the ability to accept vulnerabilities from third-party researchers means that you're always more secure, but if you don't accept them or if you don't respond to them, don't have a process for dealing with it, that does to me indicate that there is something off with the organizational structure and their commitment to security.
That's great. And on that point, I know we could talk some more, but what I'd like to do is reserve some time for audience questions.
Can I make one quick point about sourcing? So sourcing doesn't just apply like when you're buying software, right? Like as a software developer, you're sourcing open source components that are putting into your software, right? Like 90% of your code is open source software. So you also need to think about that process as part of your sourcing, right? You want to choose libraries and components that are better maintained, right? Like that get patched more often, that have a good community of support around them. Because if you plug in an open source component that has not been maintained, and you get vulnerabilities against it, and that doesn't get patched, that's a big issue for you.
Yeah.
That's a great point, thank you. I'm gonna stand up so I can see everybody in the audience and make sure that I can give everybody a chance. If you have a question, we have a microphone. There's a gentleman here who's gonna run the microphone around. Anybody have a question for our panelists? Over here, sir, you in the white.
Hello, my name is Dave Limbus from Chubb Insurance. I'm a risk engineer, and my question is for Donda. Concerning the UL framework and the fact that you've set up five different levels to evaluate IoT devices, when the kind of consensus of the panel is there should be either a good standard in developing the IoT device security or a bad standard. So if you could discuss how you, from UL perspective, figure that five different levels is of value to the industry. And again, I come from it from a perspective of trying to easily understand and assess the risk of these IoT device manufacturers.
So the UL IoT security rating framework is still, all of the five levels are still baseline security. There's other frameworks like the UL 2900 standard that take a more full-blown risk-based approach. So the five levels, even the highest level of the five, the diamond level, is still kind of the baseline security capabilities that we assess, but more comprehensively. Why do we see a need for a leveled approach? Is that if you look at the marketplace, there is a high variety of maturity levels. So some of the manufacturers are really baseline and will struggle probably to play in the ecosystem or to still be accepted in the ecosystem because it's hard for them to, even though it should not be as hard, but there's maybe not the focus to invest in it to meet at least the minimal absolute baseline capabilities, whereas others can more easily meet in the consumer IoT space as well a higher level of security that may still be not military grade security, still baseline. And want to meet that high level and differentiate their brand and their products. So we see a bit of a marketplace dynamic emerge potentially where probably to play in the ecosystem in the near future, 2020, 2021, if your product cannot demonstrate that it has a secure identity, for example, on the network, then maybe you should not be allowed to play in the ecosystem. And that could be enforced by telco or by retail or by other stakeholders. And then there's the purchasing decisions and a consumer choice, and there's good enough security and then there's better security. And security is also, it's not an endpoint, it's kind of a process. It will always evolve, and we want to give manufacturers an option to demonstrate that they are not just secure enough, but also use it as a differentiator and a value proposition to their customers.
I want to pile on just for one little bit to sort of help clarify the difference between the value add of the baseline versus the SDL, because they're closely related, but we can tease them out just a little bit. The baseline is absolutely critical for the ecosystem in the, we need as a community to say, you must be this tall to ride the internet, right? At a certain point, that's what we need. And having different tiers is going to be critical. To be at this level of inside my company, I need a certain amount than if it's just going on the wall of my home. The challenge with any baseline approach is it reflects what's unique about security. My mattress doesn't stay up all night trying to find new ways to catch on fire. For most testing, the UL pioneer model is we develop good engineering specs and we pass it and it's good forever. Security, that's not true. Windows 7 used to be secure. You can no longer in good faith tell everyone use Windows 7 and you'll be secure. The power of an SDL says, well, we can't speak to the future security. We can speak to the processes used by the organization so that we can estimate the likelihood of future flaws. And that is the real power and the work that both C2 and BSA have worked towards getting us there.
Great, thank you.
I'm Brandon Zingsheim, Minitronics Medical. So I work in the medical device industry. I'm actually at a contract design house. So we support a lot of bigger companies, but as well as inventors, people who have, you know, little VC money and a dream and a dollar, right? So they come to us, they have no understanding of cybersecurity expectations for them. Somewhat definitional question. I'm wondering, you know, a lot of our devices, I'm thinking of one right now that I'm even working on as a systems engineer. You have a device that's implanted, that's interacting with a wireless charger outside the body, but that is the system, right? And it's not tied to the internet in a direct way. So when we talk about these standards and these guidance practices from an IoT perspective, where do these kinds of devices or these systems fall in that vein? And how do the expectations maybe look a little bit different in that context where you aren't maybe directly connected to the outside world, but certainly there's vulnerabilities and exploits, right, that still can be had?
I mentioned maturity level and that there is going to be good enough security, tall enough to ride the roller coaster, and better than that to differentiate yourself in the marketplace. There's also indeed another component or aspect to this, to a matrix maybe, where you consider the complexity of the product, and based on a high degree of complexity for security purposes, you want to aim for higher levels of security as well. And indeed, whether or not you have direct access to the internet or are maybe communicating behind a hub or a router, that impacts the security complexity. If you process or store sensitive data or you don't as a device, that again has certain implications as to how complex the security risk landscape is. So that's another reason why a leveled approach makes sense to us, at least.
This will never be connected to the internet is right up there with what could possibly go wrong. For famous last words. And I mean, we have a very real example in the healthcare space of a implant where the absolutely dire security risk came through the wireless charging model, where you say, well, we can actually power cycle it in a way that is literally a matter of life and death. Now, it no one has said this is remotely attackable, but it's certainly using, I want to say it was Bluetooth near field, still puts a patient at risk. So again, threat modeling, you're always going to threat model, but never be too confident, especially if you're dealing with very large things that go boom or very small things that are critical to our life and safety.
Okay, I had a question here.
Hi, I'm Angela. I'm the Chief Innovation Officer for a company called Sharify. We do cloud services, but I'm actually going to put on my mom hat today, and I have some questions. As the Chief Purchasing Officer of our household for IoT things, you know, we all know about the stickers that go on lamps that say UL listed, and so we feel comfortable buying those. What does the industry and government agencies do to make people aware of these third-party ratings for these devices so that when I'm in my mom's group and we're talking about the next thing to buy, this becomes a question we ask each other?
So there are a number of initiatives across the U.S. government that have been very powerful at trying to promote this. The Federal Trade Commission, I believe we have some of my government colleagues in the FTC, are here at CES today. One of the points I want to make is while I definitely want to be able to empower the smart consumer who cares about protecting his or her family, I also don't want the security of the ecosystem to depend on your ability to read a label. Energy Star is a great example. Everyone understands it. It's measuring a single dimension. And if you ever read the history, a massive amount of engineering went into understanding power consumption dynamics to get to that. For things like security and data privacy and other areas, we are talking a multidimensional issue, which is going to be very hard. And we just had a question of, well, do we really need five levels of assurance for a sophisticated UL model? I want to be able to empower you, but I also don't want our public policy to depend on that empowerment.
Yeah, I'd like to add something to that, because we've done a lot as CTA, the Trade Association for the Consumer Technology Industry. We've done a lot of investigation into this, and one of the things that we've concluded pretty clearly is that it's not helpful to have a government mandate for a label yet, if ever. The reason is that there's not enough information out there, like a panel like this, where people are able to comply. And so to start educating consumers, you need to look for this private security label or super security label or whatever it is. You need to look for this label, and then they go to Best Buy or Target or Walmart, and they can't find any products with it, is actually counterproductive. So the industry effort has primarily been on establishing the standards and specifications. And we do have a very well-trusted name in UL, so that's a little bit easier messaging. And so if UL is providing that label, that's a little bit more clear picture. CTIA, formerly the Cellular Telecommunications Industry Association, now just branded CTIA, they have a certification program as well, because they work with the carriers, and the carriers are very interested about the devices that go on their networks, and so they want a certification process. But that's more of a B2B, even though I think it will spin out, I believe it will spin out over time to be more consumer friendly. But right now, it's really important to get the specifications and requirements in place so that people can learn how to comply, get their software, their secure development lifecycle up and running, and then get into the compliance and assessment. For the more mature companies that are able to survive an assessment, we have organizations like UL.
So can I add a couple of points to that?
Yeah, please do.
So I understand the desire for certification and labeling, and that's not necessarily misguided, but the challenge, so I would say when you go and buy IoT devices or anything else for your household, use the same kind of logic that you use when you buy anything else for your house, right? So I drink a lot of tea. It's a bit of a problem. So teas are, apparently it turns out there can be a lot of contamination in teas from different kinds of things, right? So when you're going, when you go grocery shopping and you do any kind of thing, right, you're not going to, some person in the middle of the street who is, just has a card and is just giving away vegetables at, 50 cents, right? And you're like, oh, that's the cheapest vegetable. I should go buy that instead of going to my local supermarket where the same vegetable is $5. I think you should think about, why is it that it's 50 cents here and $5 in your local supermarket, right? Use the same kind of logic. Well, how is it that I'm able to get a camera for $5 on this retailer, which is promising me the world and the moon? How are they able to make something for such a low price point, right? Which is not to say that something that is $500 is going to be secure, but I think something that's $5 is probably not going to be very secure. The other thing is, as you're thinking about getting some of these devices, just, try, one of the challenges in security is how do you measure it, right? And kind of going back to the point, you said there are multi-dimensions, but I don't even think that is a multi-dimensional concept, right? Because it's an ever-evolving thing. To Alan's point, no one is setting, my mattress is not setting itself on fire, right? So, use kind of common knowledge and then look for things online, right? If you see, bad news stories about a particular vendor, they're probably not doing that much to invest in this in the security of their products.
Okay, thank you. We have time for one last really quick question.
So as a device developer in the medical field in particular, my company's getting more mature at this, but one thing we don't do well right now is evaluate our devices. And that's typically a pretty manual process. Are there any tools out there that we could use to help us evaluate interfaces on devices?
So if the question is, how can we more seamlessly assess devices? What are tools that we can be leveraging? There is a host of software testing tools out there. I'm not going to recommend any specific vendors, or there's a lot of open source tools. So yes, there is a lot of assist that you can get and that your security experts or development teams can get for testing devices also regularly and in-house. Through a rigorous process based on a security development lifecycle policy overall. Following these frameworks, also the UL IoT security rating requirements, for example, those are all public. That's kind of the guide, I think, that you should adhere to if you do some of the assessment work also in-house. But yeah, there's a lot of, there's a ton of assistance out there.
Terrific. BG?
Can I add, sorry, going back to the previous question, I do think there's two simple proxies that you can use. They're not, does this company accept vulnerability reports from third-party researchers? If they don't, this is my opinion, not the opinion of my company or anyone I represent, I would not buy a product from them. Right? The second one is, are they providing patches for my product that I'm buying? I think like those are true proxies that you can use. If they're not patching your product, and like different companies have different models. I actually saw a company on the floor yesterday. They charged a yearly fee, I think, of $7 to continue providing patches. I think that's a fair trade. You want security, you have to pay for it.
So go to the website, see if they have some resource for security researchers, a landing page for security researchers to report bugs, and look to see if they support patches, security patches. I want to thank our panelists. Please join me in thanking our panelists. This is a really great amount of information. And thank everyone here in the audience for joining us today and our live stream audience. We are looking forward to three more very full days, today, tomorrow, and Friday of this show. If you're here, fabulous. If you're not here, man, get a plane ticket, get out of here. It's amazing what's on the show floor. So thank you, everybody, and have a great show.